So let us come to the particular provision in the African Charter on Human and People's Rights that deals with freedom of expression. It is Article 9, and it is divided into 9.1 and 9.2, two sub-articles. The one speaking about the passive, the kind of receptive part of freedom of expression, and the other to the expressive, the more active part. So 9.1 reads, every individual shall have the right to receive information. And 9.2 reads, every individual shall have the right to express and disseminate his opinions within the law. So that within the law alerts us to the very basic and important principle that rights may be limited. Limitation of rights would be a legitimate state interest that would allow for the routinely justifiable restriction or limitation, or at least curtailment of a person's rights. So for example, we could find in a democratic society that there is a law that prohibits hate speech, or speech that flames up and tries to instill violence or propagate violence against particular groups within a state. That law, a hate speech law, would clearly limit the free expression of journalists or anyone in society. But it is quite possible that that law, the hate speech law, would be justifiable and acceptable. So one of the tasks of anyone involved in this field of human rights would be to find the balance between the rights and their invocation on the one hand and the limitation, and whether such a limitation is justifiable on the other hand. Now, the framing of the African Charter Article 9 as the right to have your free expression and right to disseminate within the law was something that caused concern. The reason for this is that the phrase within the law is not in any sense further qualified. It seems to suggest that the state may limit a right merely by reference to law, any law, doesn't matter what the content of that law is. Now, clearly this would leave us uneasy. Interestingly, in the history and the drafting of the Charter, the concerns were expressed about these clauses. They were called actually clawback clauses, something like a lion's paw, clawing back, giving and taking away at the same time. So you have the right to freedom of expression, but the government seems to be allowed to totally eradicate and pull back on that right. Now, fortunately for us, when the African Commission on Human and People's Rights, that body which monitors and interprets the African Charter, when it had its first opportunity to interpret this provision, it did not accept the interpretation that the state can merely restrict these rights with reference to any national law. In this case, I'm referring to Media Rights Agenda versus Nigeria. It comes from the time of the dictatorship of Sani Abacha in Nigeria. Certain restrictive laws, actually decrees, were issued. Decree, in other words, not a law that had gone through parliament, that was merely wishes of the military ruler. Those laws restricted, curtailed freedom of expression. They instituted a difficult process to get accreditation, if you like, to be able to function as a newspaper or a magazine. Journalists, those interested in freedom of expression at the domestic level in Nigeria, they tried to fight this law. They were unsuccessful and eventually went to the African Commission. And the African Commission then had to say, is the law, are these decrees issued by Sani Abacha, are they legitimate restrictions on the freedom of expression? So on the one hand, if you like, let us imagine ourselves back at the forum when the commission was hearing this case. The government of Nigeria would have been represented by lawyers who argued that the Abacha decrees were laws as referred to in Article 9, and by virtue of being a law, they were legitimate restrictions on freedom of expression. No further questions asked. That was the argument. On the other side, the media rights agenda and others argued that clearly you cannot merely invoke a law without any further to justify limitations. You have to show that that law serves a particular purpose and that that purpose is societally important and that that law and its importance outweighs any harm and restriction on the individual and his or her rights. And the Commission accepted and embraced that interpretation. So from that case onwards, all the provisions in the African Charter that had these clawback clauses had now been interpreted to mean there has to be what is called in our legal terminology a proportionality test. In every case where there is a limitation justifiably invoked by the government, there is a necessity, a need to apply the proportionality test, where on the one hand you'll put in the scale of justice, as it were, the individual, his or her rights, and how far-reaching the invasion by that limitation is of the rights of the individual. And on the other side of the scale, you'll put the law that limits the rights. How important is that limitation, that law, in the societal context? And one will have to, as a court, as a body that adjudicates, make up one's mind about how this is to be determined. But the point is, the mere reliance on law itself cannot be a reason to limit, justifiably limit rights, including freedom of expression. It's important perhaps also just for a moment to distinguish between limitations and derogations of rights. Limitations are, for example, the hate speech law or another law, for example, a law on criminal defamation that some states have, a law that says that if you defame another person, you may be criminally responsible. In other words, you may have to pay a fine or you may be put in prison. Those kinds of laws are laws that purport to limit the right to freedom of expression on a regularized basis. Derogation of rights is something quite different. That would be, for example, during a state of emergency, where a legitimate state of emergency has been called, certain rights may just not be available to be invoked by individuals. They are suspended. So when there's derogation of rights, rights are suspended. I could say that they are like put on ice. They are frozen away. They could, after the state of emergency, be kind of unfrozen and brought back to life. But they are suspended and not available for the duration of the emergency. And that is something that should always be seen as irregular and pertaining to an exceptional situation. That is not the general limitation of rights. In one of the cases before the African Court, Konate versus against Burkina Faso, the issue of criminal defamation had to be determined. And the laws of Burkina Faso regulated that if, for example, a defamatory article is written by a journalist, statement is made by someone, the act of defaming is made a criminal offense. And the criminal offense could lead to terms of imprisonment and to quite a long term of imprisonment as well. And the case in Konate was about the specifics of Mr. Konate, a journalist, the fact that he was imprisoned for having, according to the court, the courts of Burkina Faso, defamed a politician. But secondly, the case was also about the mere existence of such a law. Should there be laws in place that actually criminalize defamation? Should we not go the civil law route in case of defamation? In other words, we should leave it to that party, that person, that politician that feels that his, her rights have been infringed, his dignity has been infringed, to bring a case, to sue, to ask for damages against the infringing party. So in the judgment, which you will look at and read in depth, you will see that the case is decided on the first leg in particular, that the court finds that imprisonment for criminal defamation is disproportionate. So the case turns eventually on the form of punishment for criminal defamation. So the bigger question of whether there should in the first place be laws criminalizing defamation, the court did not pronounce a violation on that specific issue. And if one reads the case, you'll see there were a number of amici curiae, friends of the court. The Center for Human Rights, where we are and who are involved in this module, the center is an NGO that has observer status also with the African Commission, and the NGO was part of the Friends of the Court, the Amici Curiae. And our case was that essentially all criminalization of defamation would constitute a violation of the African Charter, because in our view, it stifles freedom of expression. The mere fact that there's a criminal law that a state, another person may invoke to come after someone who's merely expressed views, perhaps negative views, criticisms of another person, the fact that there is such a criminal law, we think unjustifiably and disproportionately infringes on the freedom of expression. And because it kind of stifles free speech, one should rather merely say there should be civil law and civil regulation of how to redress defamation in a democratic society. That certainly is the ideal.